Forgive me, but my schedule has changed. The time for grace and good manners has now run out.
Please. Torture will not work on me. Surely you know this.
Oh, I have no intention of getting rough with you. You haven't been beaten. Your hands aren't even tied. Just like me, you live in symbiosis with countless parasites. What wounds I might inflict, they'll patch right up. You might feel considerable pain, but I've no doubt you can withstand it.
Then what do you plan on doing?
I have a soldier standing outside. Nothing special about him, except that he always obeys. I have given him one instruction. Whenever I ring this bell, he passes on a message for me. That message is simply, go.
What is this?
After that, though, it gets complicated. The message will arrive at a room, a little bigger than this one, nothing special. Some of your people are in this room, surrounded by my men.
Enough of this.
They pick them at random. No regard for age, gender. In that, I suppose, they're different from you. Not as discriminating. They tied them up, one by one, blindfolded them. We had to maintain order, you understand?
You bastard!
Go. When they hear that, my men will pick one of your people and infect them with a parasite. Your parasite.
It won't work on my people.
True. The vocal cord parasite doesn't respond to your language. But what about English?
An English strain. It exists.
A ring of this bell, and they infect one person. If that person abandons the Navajo language, the English strain will trigger symptoms.
You monster!
So, it's quite simple. Every time I ring the bell, another of your people is infected.
Don't do this!
I don't want to do this. I'd rather not have to ring the bell, which is why I'm hoping you will talk to me.
What do you want? What else could you possibly want?
You know the answer to that. How to prevent the symptoms caused by the parasite.
You cannot control it like some slave. Forget the idea.
Forget it? Unlikely.
I will never tell you. What have you done?
You made me do that.
You black-hearted...
Settle down.
Don't use it again.
Well, that is up to you. All you need to do is tell me what I want. How to prevent the vocal cord parasite symptoms.
Why? Why do you need to know?
The adult soldiers at Gwalayamasa are all dead.
What?
The parasite traveled downstream.
How?
It would appear that he was involved. Another demon who woke up from 9 years of slumber. As a result, the vocal cord parasite spread through the village.
I told you this would happen.
It was an unfortunate accident. He is becoming an annoyance. He may stumble upon the truth sooner or later, but I suppose that is really of no consequence. One day, he too will pay for what he has done.
Black Anna, the real demon. Is you.
You know, this incident made me realize something. You are right. I should have acted with more humility. These creatures cannot be controlled. All the more reason I require a means to stop them.
There is no such way.
Oh, really?
Wait! Don't ring it again.
It is up to you. Out with it!
I see now. There must be more to it than that.
What?
They are in you. You use this land to breed more of my children. And not just here. No. in pursuit of your ethnic cleansers. You sifted through many language strains, finding hosts, breeding more and more. You would have been infected in the process, infected with countless strains. Most likely your mother tongues as well. Romania, Northern Transylvania. You found that one too. Yes, the Hungarian strain that responds to the CK's dialect.
Silence!
Black Anna, it is you who shall pay.
Is this your retaliation, old man?
Let my people go, and never bother them again! You heard me. What now? What? No! What are you doing?
I am not afraid. I probably have every language strain inside of me, meaning all the world's languages are already lost to me. But that suits me fine. If need be, I myself can produce whatever strain is needed.
And that means nothing to you. If you are infected, you can never again speak your mother tongue. Otherwise, you will die. As will every one of your countrymen.
A few words here and there won't trigger the symptoms. And besides, the time is not yet right to show this face in my homeland. Not until my revenge is complete. Now...
Stop!
We're out of time. I have to get going. Well...
No! Radiation. It's radiation.
Radiation, of course. So it can be used.
But how much? I do not know.
Radiation denatures their reproductive cells, preventing them from mating.
Same principle as the sterilization technique. The reproductive cells are more sensitive to radiation than the rest of the body. But I have not tested it. There is no telling what mutation could result, or how the host may be affected. Not to mention what could happen if this is done post-infection.
I don't care. This plan goes into action now. As long as it works, the details can wait. You wouldn't be lying to me, of course, old man.
I can guarantee nothing.
I owe you my life. My body has been burned on countless occasions, but it survives, thanks to your children. That is why I trust you.
Then do not repeat my mistake.
What's that?
In the West, it is said that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. In the East, it is said the man of flesh brings spiritual power to words. The people knew back then that these creatures carry the gospel. They do not belong in our hands. They must not be touched.
How enlightening. I'll remember that. Consider this. My thanks.
What are you?
Catch.
No!
Well then. I'm afraid it really is goodbye this time, Code Talker.
Huh? There is no soldier.
Huh. Now where did he run off to?
Huh?
Guess he wasn't as obedient as I thought.
There never was any soldier.
So long.
You! How dare you!
Boss, we gave Ralph, that kid who died in the accident, a burial at sea. The man in charge of that facility has been severely punished. But ever since, the kids have been acting strange. It's obvious they've lost their trust in adults. I was getting reports of them ignoring the staff, or getting insolent, and even violent. And a few days later, several of the kids did a disappearing act. They snuck into choppers and shipping containers and got off base. Why? Your guess is as good as mine. These kids were born in a war zone, and forced to grow up as war fighters. If they're left alone, war is how they'll die. But I thought we showed them there are other reasons to live. I never liked having children on Mother Base. But the thought of them going back to the battlefield and picking up their old lifestyle is something I can't stomach. It makes me think of Chico, 9 years ago. We have to get those kids back. Hell, they know too much about our operation. I never expected even the kids to betray us.
The whole base is busy getting ready for Peace Day. Miller has finished writing his song, so I went with Professor Galvez to listen to it. Miller was really into it, humming away as he played the song on his acoustic guitar. But the song melody did not match up with the guitar chords at all, and it sounded more like a mess than music. Miller's very enthusiastic, but I think he's tone deaf. I guess the guitar backing sounded good at least. But as I was wondering how to break it to Miller, Professor Galvez took out an odd instrument. It was just two antennas sticking out of a box, more like a radio than a musical instrument. He said it was invented by the Soviets, but why would Professor Galvez own a Soviet-Russian instrument? I asked him, and he told me music has no borders. Well, I cannot argue with that. Good music is something people of any nation can appreciate. Why not abandon war and just make music together? But anyway, the professor offered to try playing the melody on his instrument in time with Miller's guitar. It was like something from another world. But somehow, it fit Miller's guitar backing really well. It even gave the song a charming, down-home kind of feeling. Miller was overjoyed. "That is it! That is my melody right there," he said. It sounded totally different from when he sang it. But hearing the professor's version, I thought I could probably sing it. Then Miller hit me with the next bombshell. "Buzz, you write the lyrics." I did not know whether to scream or to run out of the room. There was only 1 week left until Peace Day.
I have spoken enough. Your men can take it from here. Will you permit me to rest? Have something to eat?
I thought you don't eat.
I can subsist without food. But there is more to the act of eating than nourishment. We receive nature's blessings, and we affirm our part in it. And in doing so, we express our gratitude.
Sorry, it's, hearing you say you don't need to eat and that you're a part of nature in the same breath. Anyway, what can we get you? Not exactly a five-star restaurant, but the kitchen's used to serving a lot of different appetites.
Hamburgers.
Hamburgers?
Even we Diné have become Americanized. I eat them often back home.
And you just can't let them go. Well, as far as symbols of the American Empire go, hamburgers are pretty good. The victory of capitalism. Your people suffered so much at the hands of America, and you asked for hamburgers.
We have suffered more than you can know. But I do not see hamburgers as an accomplice. A single dish, providing a balanced helping of nature's blessings. Meat, grain, and vegetable. How could anyone hate such a magnificent thing?
Says the guy who can survive on photosynthesis. Balance has nothing to do with it. You just like a good burger.
That is also true. Be warned, though. I have very high standards.
Don't worry. I do too. All right, then. One good old-fashioned all-American icon coming up.
I look forward to it. I hope you bought a better hamburger this time, Kazuhira.
Right.
Weather will clear
well,
shortly.
The last one was lacking in every way. The patty was too thin, the bun too dry, and the lettuce, days old at best.
Hey, that was 100% all-beef patty, and no shortening in the bun either.
Nature's blessings. Unadulterated, in hamburger form. Is that it? But when taste falls short, so does our gratitude to nature. Making such precious blessings unpalatable is sacrilege.
I hate to admit it, but I think you're right. I should have known better than to settle for second best. That's why I had him run some more R&D. Develop a new burger. In fact, one of our researchers just dropped by with the latest results. Here it is. See how you like this.
We shall see indeed.
Analysis complete.
I thank you for this bounty, Mother Earth.
So, what's the verdict?
Not bad.
And?
But it does not hold a candle to what I ate back home.
Everyone's a critic. Damn it. I was sure the Kobe beef... But maybe we didn't have enough. We had any more. We're cutting into our profits.
Profits?
We'll be taking a loss on every unit.
What are you talking about?
Huh? Anyway, I'll be back with another round of product.
I will be waiting. Did you say product?
Snake, you remember the White Mamba? Of course, he's been going by Eli since we brought him on base. He was the leader of the child soldier unit we took out of that village and into our protection. Well, according to the kids you brought back here, all the escapees were especially close to Eli. There's reason to suspect he's behind all six escapes. We've already detained him. I'll be questioning him shortly.
Wait. You'll be?
Ocelot.
You're incapable of taking an impartial stance with those kids. Question them all you want. It'll get you nowhere.
Ocelot, you get too many kicks from your art of interrogation.
It's not a matter of art. It's about quick, minimal strokes of psychological warfare. That's what gets the answers. And it's the best way to keep both questioner and subject safe. The risks only increase the more an interrogation drags on. At that point, it causes as much pain to the inflictor as the inflicted.
Like I said, too many kicks.
What I'm trying to tell you is we need quick results. Otherwise, it'll be too little, too late.
I know that.
And besides, I know the subject. I won't go overboard with a kid.
Forget it. You're not needed. Snake, we'll want to question the other kids too. Be sure to bring them all back. Snake, about the escaped children. Eli confessed. The way he tells it, they wanted to go back to the battlefield. Don't rob them of their freedom, he said. If you bring them all back, there will be consequences.
Next, he'll be asking for our surrender.
Consequences? What consequences?
No idea. That's all I have for now.
You're too attached to those kids. Stop protecting Eli.
Listen to yourself.
Let me question him, and we'll get some real answers.
Not necessary. I'll report as and when.
Boss, we found weapons in the children's section of the living quarters. As you know, weapons are strictly off-limits. We've got some rule breakers. The weapons we found were handmade. Blades ground out of knives and forks, a couple of bow guns built out of scrap, and explosives made using detergents. And get this, the explosives were tightly packed with nails. The kids put the blame on, you guessed it, Eli. I guess that's what he meant by consequences.
I questioned him about it, but this time he claimed they want to be put out on missions. Send us to the battlefield, he says.
Miller, enough is enough. You've protected him too much already. It's my turn to question him.
Protected?
What Eli's doing is issuing a threat. Comply with my demands or I'll respond with force.
But
it'll be war at this rate. Forks and soap aren't gonna kill us, but some of them will end up dead. Is that what you want? Now, I hate to say it, but they want to be on the battlefield. It's time you gave up this fantasy.
Eli, he said they'd rise up against us if we bring the last kid back.
There, you see? Ignore his demands. Don't let him return to quarters. That attitude is contagious. We'd lose control over them for good.
For the time being, we've confiscated those handmade weapons. We're bumping up security and the number of psychiatric counselors. As for Eli,
he needs some very special care.
You mean solitary?
Well, we can't leave him in contact with the other kids. If you won't do it, I will. Boss, keep working on extracting those kids.
The kids you brought back to base have laid out the situation. They all escaped to each of their home villages, or were trying to get home, and lost their way. Not that homesickness is gonna explain everything we've seen.
Each of their home villages? They were trying to raise troops for the rebellion.
You really think these kids have an armed uprising in them?
You read the report of the security team member who had a rock thrown at him. There'll be a riot if we don't do something. And Miller, this is because you didn't act fast enough.
Fine. I'll admit you were right this time.
Seal off the kids' quarters from outside contact before it's too late.
All right.
Eli said his rebellion would start when the last kid is brought back, right? You better be ready to meet him head-on if it really happens.
Yeah.
You should have left it to me in the first place.
Boss, they're just kids. We have a responsibility to see that those kids make it. It's not about feeling protective or the pros and cons. I hate kids. That's exactly what I heard from the people who raised me. People who abandoned me, more like. That's the spark that kept me going, you know? I wanted to show those adults what I was made of. Wanted to get back at them one day. But before I knew it, I was all grown up. Never saw it coming. All of a sudden, people treated me as an adult. Some adult I turned out to be. But I feel like if my life had been different, if the adults I knew had been different, I could have grown up better. Yeah, that's it, all right. I wanted to use those kids to test that theory. That's all this was. From their point of view, I'm no different from the assholes who gave me a hard time. When this is all blown over, I'll talk it out with them. If that's still possible. Boss, there are still kids out there. Bring them back safe.
Boss, it's me. Eli's revealed what he wants. He wants to speak with you, with Big Boss. He just said, bring my father here. Eli's too smart for his own good. No way to tell what he's thinking. All we know for sure is his men are important to him. That means we can use the escaped kids as leverage in any negotiation. Once you've brought the last one back, I'll interrogate him. If the kids do rise up, we'll meet them full force. End of story. I didn't want things to turn out like this, We could have prevented it, but it's too late now. If Eli means to take this all the way, he's gonna force us to do the same. Boss, go get that last kid. We've finished decoding the informant's report. That floating kid we've run into a few times now. Looks like he was a test subject in clinical experiments. The Soviets called him the Third Boy. The Third Boy was brought to a lab on the outskirts of Moscow from Czechoslovakia, after which he was due to be sent to a research center in Leningrad, then Siberia, and finally an academic town in Novosibirsk. It doesn't appear that the researchers witnessed the talents we've seen from him, but nevertheless, he was quite the popular subject. His latent cognitive abilities suddenly awoke en route to Moscow. According to the report, the Third Boy was easily influenced by other individuals' biofields. Evil thoughts, in particular. They affected his mind like a virus. Extreme anger or resentment, motives for revenge, in other words. Now, during the transport flight to Moscow, the boy was exposed to a powerful mental energy field coming from a certain individual. Ever since, being conscious of his powers, he's become a sort of energy generator. What's unique about him is the way his acute telepathic abilities get taken over by another person's will. The boy began to physically parasitize individuals experiencing extreme anger and codify the host's desires. This includes amplifying the host's natural strengths. Or, in accordance with the host's desires, he can also implant program code in another individual, making them a puppet, essentially. Human neural synapses transmit weak electrical currents between neurons. These electrical currents, though at a level difficult to observe, warp the magnetic field outside the body. The Third Boy is able to pick up these weak fluctuations. Contrary to psychotronics, which involves controlling the human mind, his abilities as a receptor are too high. The emotions he picks up from another individual are amplified and unleashed into his body as they recur in his brain. They turn into microwaves, which then affect the physical world, triggering paranormal phenomena like the spontaneous combustion of organic matter or psychokinesis, moving an object without touching it. There's one other thing. While he's parasitizing a host, the boy's ego gets shut away, allowing the will of the host to take control of his powers. Like some annoying static drowning out your own voice. That means he isn't responsible for what's been happening. Somebody's extreme anger has manifested through the Third Boy's powers in ways none of us could have predicted, which would mean this was going on somewhere around us. Looking back on it, a lot of things make sense now. The man on fire, Sahelanthropus, they both came to life thanks to the Third Boy's powers. Everything has been happening through him as a catalyst. We first saw him in the hospital on Cyprus. The boy parasitizing the man on fire's desire for revenge gave him his new abilities in return. He next appeared at the Hamid Fighters Fort where the honeybee was hidden. There, the boy parasitized Skullface's vengeful mind. He controlled Sahelanthropus, making it do whatever Skullface wanted. Same goes for when we extracted Emmerich onto the chopper. When he appeared at the Devil's House in Central Africa, Skullface's will controlled the man on fire via the Third Boy's powers. Everything is clear up to this point. But even the informant couldn't pinpoint who the host was in the cave within Serac Power Plant. Sahelanthropus suddenly became active, then crushed not only the man on fire, but Skullface as well. Surely neither of them could have been the host. Who else was at that location and bore anger more extreme than either of them? Whose will was controlling Sahelanthropus? According to the report, emotions transmitted in children's brains affect the surrounding magnetic field more strongly. Cerebral nerves are covered with insulation called myelin sheaths to increase impulse speed. The reason for this leakage has to do with the fact that children's myelin sheaths are still developing. So, how many children do you remember being there? Children with a burning desire for revenge and bearing a grudge against you. I can think of only one. Eli. We don't know what kind of life he's had, but the resentment he's shown toward adults is nothing short of extraordinary. The third boy resonated with Eli's mind. And that means Eli bore the strongest animosity of all individuals within the boy's reception range, estimated to be a 3-mile radius, beating out even Volgan and Skullface. The third boy has probably remained hooked on Eli's anger since. You remember at the Devil's House, the third boy showed an interest in Shabani? That must have been his ego making a rare appearance. He may possess abilities far beyond anyone else in the world, but he's still a kid. Maybe them both being kids was enough to bring them together. And if so, maybe with Eli, he isn't feeding off him, but acting in symbiosis with him. So what kickstarted the third boy's powers? If we look at the location and time that his plane went down, we can make a pretty good guess. When the plane experienced the first anomaly, it gave an accurate report of its position to a control tower, due north of the Black Sea, 125 miles east of Kiev. Dead south on the Black Sea is Cyprus's Green Line. So the plane's position was directly north of the hospital where you'd been asleep for 9 years. And this anomaly was reported at exactly the same time that you woke up. The plane was enveloped in flame from the inside out. The fuselage burnt to ashes. There were no survivors, at least not publicly admitted. Your thoughts formed a synchronicity with the boy's psyche and were amplified inside his brain. That would have been more than enough to trigger his abilities. Your rage was like a big bang in his head, blowing the lid off his powers. The boy was then secretly moved to the lab outside of Moscow where Volgan was comatose. There, Volgan's thoughts resonated with the boy and he was awakened. Volgan became the man on fire, hell-bent on getting revenge on you. His instincts led him straight to you. Skullface knew Volgan from Operation Snake Ear, or perhaps from even before. Monitoring this pair of extraordinaries, he discovered the hospital and sent his assassin and XOF. Skullface was probably watching the situation from close by. Then, realizing how useful these two test subjects could be, he approached them. Reacting to Skullface's thirst for revenge, this time the boy let Skullface's will control Volgan. Volgan, at times driven by personal revenge, at times through Skullface's will, kept on moving, though his body was little more than dead meat. Perhaps there were moments where even your thoughts affected him as well. But without the boy's power, it was like the plug had been pulled from the socket. Everything was powered by anger, malice, revenge. This is how the end of the report sums things up. Both the third boy and the man on fire were originally test subjects of paranormal research for military applications, like telekinetically controlling the leader of an enemy nation and making him launch a nuke, or stopping the heart of someone on the wrong side of the Berlin Wall, experimenting with latent human abilities. They were used as tools of the Cold War. The boy's only crime was being born with unique gifts. But he was sacrificed on the altar of war, his life reduced to slavery under other people's wills, turned into a living weapon with no will of his own. Eventually, the only emotion he could feel must have been the desire to get revenge for the hand he'd been dealt. Boss, it's you that awakened the boy's powers. But there's more to it than that. I guess the anger emanating from you was something he could truly relate to. Feeling hungry, old-timer?
Old-timer? I do not get hungry, no. But you have a new hamburger?
You guessed it, and this time we use lamb.
Lamb?
You're not a lamb kind of guy?
A hamburger is made of beef. Who ever heard of a hamburger without beef?
Yeah, but we gotta stay fresh, stand out from our competition.
You're what?
Just give it a try.
If you say so. Not bad. call this a hamburger?
I thought we were onto something this time. Maybe the problem is that it looks like a regular hamburger. Gotta think outside the box. Too much baggage if they come in expecting just another burger. Let's see, cotton candy? To make it look like a sheep? Yeah.
Just a minute. You really think people would eat that? What is it you are planning? Are you using me? A taste tester? A one-man focus group?
Well, actually, I've already started. I got a place called, Miller's Maxi Buns.
You are kidding me.
Well, to be honest, business hasn't been great. No one seems to like my, buns.
The Ocelot said Diamond Dog's budget did not add up. But you don't mean to tell me.
What? No. Our black budget's got it all covered. I'm not embezzling GMP or anything. Still, let's not say anything to Snake, okay?
Very well. However, Kazuhira, it takes more than premium ingredients and a clever recipe to satisfy the palate.
Okay, so what do?
The palate seeks one thing, chemical additives.
Chemical additives.
There is nothing mysterious or spiritual about good flavor. The tongue simply identifies specific amino acids, which the brain then recognizes as appealing. Therefore, all that is needed is to chemically isolate those amino acids and incorporate them into your products. To be clear, I speak of flavor. The rest is irrelevant.
That seems a little extreme.
Do not forget that I am a scientist after all. And using science for the benefit of others is a joy. In seeking coexistence with nature's blessings, not everything can remain in its natural form. When we fall ill, we must be treated. Otherwise, that very nature could cost us our lives. Agriculture is one of nature's many blessings. But through that process, we damage the surrounding vegetation.
Yeah. Whether it's a massive farm or a tiny field, we always leave our mark on the land.
The same is true of parasites. And for food preparation. If tapeworms in the raw meat of another animal enter the human body, they roam around trying to find their usual habitat, sometimes even eating away at the brain in their confusion. So in looking through a scientific point of view, you see the necessity for processing food. Yes, it is also sometimes necessary to eliminate certain parasites, or selectively use or even modify others. Alternatively, we could say that if a man is part of nature, the work he does is also part of it. What is important is the balance.
Yeah, you're right. Thanks, old-timer. You really opened my eyes. I fooled myself into thinking people today wanted high-quality, all-natural goods. But my favorite burgers were never about that. What they want is something like the first burger I had in America when I went to meet my dad. A Frankenburger loaded with additives. That's the America I knew and loved. I'll be back in a jiffy, old-timer. My next burger's gonna knock your socks off.
Kazuhira, wait. What is important is how we balance the... Quick for a one-legged man. Frankenburger? What kind of a dive did your old man take you to?
What was your goal in having the children repair Sahelanthropus?
I just answered their questions. I had no idea they would actually try to fix it. I mean, can you imagine a child piloting it?
Oh, sure. Easily.
It wouldn't work.
Well, I bet it's just like riding a bike.
I said it didn't work. It...
Who did you try?
I didn't.
Did you put your son in it?
We never did that.
His name was, Hal, wasn't it? I thought you said you never saw his face. But you made him pilot Sahelanthropus. You used him in your experiments.
He wanted to get in. It was such a short time we had.
So he was with you.
We were happy.
You're still happy now. Changing your lies to suit the listener and getting by slipping through the cracks. Building layer upon layer of convenient stories until nothing means anything to you anymore. You're happy all the time because you don't even notice you're doing it. Think hard. Who are you really? You're not a victim and you're not the silent majority. You're a perpetrator and a petty hypocrite. The real world doesn't make you suffer. It's the other way around.
Well, Doctor, I have the report on the incident at the quarantine facility. Assuming the vocal cord parasite evolved, underwent a mutation. The only plausible explanations are exposure to some high-concentration mutagen or radiation. As you know, some of the staff at the quarantine facility were infected with the parasites. The Wolbachia prevented them from copulating, but the parasites themselves can't be removed from their host's vocal cords. Once you're infected with Skullface's parting gift, you're stuck with it. The researchers regularly used X-ray equipment to monitor the parasites in their throats. No problem there, they kept a close eye on the radiation doses. But that equipment didn't just give off X-rays. It was also emitting beta rays, even though that's unnecessary for the scans. See, beta rays have far worse effects on DNA than X-rays, meaning the only logical conclusion is that someone added in a beta ray emitter to trigger a mutation. Those beta rays leaked out from inside the equipment. Because the emitter was retrofitted, the shielding was inadequate. And the person who ordered and inspected the equipment was you, Doctor. That makes you the only person with the opportunity to install that emitter.
So now you're saying I sabotaged medical equipment for some wild plan to make the vocal cord parasite kill everyone?
Or maybe you thought it'd reveal a way to treat the parasite without using the Wolbachia. And with that much to barter, I suppose some people would welcome even a pathetic cur like you.
Just stop it!
You'd have no shortage of buyers, but most would be happy with just the parasite. You wouldn't need to offer anything else. However, if that buyer already knew about the parasite, they'd also know that by itself, it's no longer the ultimate bargaining chip it once was. To sell to that buyer, you need to throw in a bonus, a way to one-up it. There's only one buyer who'd be after that.
Emmerich, we record all communications on Mother Base. That includes radio transmissions to and from homemade devices. You've been in frequent contact with people in America. A private biotech company, a client of which is DARPA. And they are connected to Cypher. You made a deal with Cypher. You offered them a new parasite in exchange for your safety. This is the only place in the world where the vocal cord parasite still exists. And you used it as a testing ground, tried to resurrect their bioweapon. But your plan to obtain the parasite has failed. Your bullshit ends now. And don't think you're leaving here alive.
Boss, we've got the results of Eli's genetic tests. We can finally put this worry behind us.
We used the PCR technique and conducted DNA fingerprinting of the copied DNA sequences. Neither is mainstream science yet, but the concepts and procedures are sound. Both tests say there is 0% chance that the two of you are blood relatives, meaning the results are negative. He's not your son, nor is he your clone. He's just another person.
It was 12 years ago that Zero made plans to clone you. Eli's age and appearance certainly are a good fit. I admit the first time I saw him, I did a double take. But it looks like we were worried for nothing. Eli isn't your clone. Though you might still have one somewhere out there.
But if Eli isn't the boss's clone, why does he seem so obsessed with him? Not to mention having one hell of an attitude for his age.
I don't know. Learning the truth about himself, cursing the fact he's a clone, bearing a grudge against selfish adults, and coming to hate who he was cloned from. Big Boss. If that were really the case, I could understand it. I might even feel a bit sorry for him. But no clone could have a totally different DNA fingerprint. And the test left no room for error. You yourself were there when we drew Eli's blood sample.
Come to think of it, when we went to OKB-0, he'd snuck onto a chopper and was there.
Yeah.
He was acting strange even then. Or actually from a little before that time.
That was exactly when we began these tests.
Maybe he suspected something when we drew the sample, not knowing what we were doing to him, and becoming mistrustful of us.
Hard to say. Eli's had an attitude problem from day one.
So what is he then?
Well, if he's gonna tell us that himself, we'll need to get him to open up more first. Skullface. Real name unknown. Born in Hungary. More specifically, northern Transylvania, after it reverted to Hungary from Romania. While he was young, the country allied with Germany as part of the Axis powers, but later during the war, it came under Soviet occupation. The Hungarians struggled for independence, but the Soviets came down. Hard. Just like he said, time and again, the country was ruled by a foreign tongue. When he was a young boy, he lost his native language. The bedrock for any developing child. His country, his family, his face, his identity, everything was stolen from him. All he had left was his skull. Skullface first tried his hand at espionage during all the chaos from the war. Agents, military officials, and soldiers who operated out of Hungary during the war vanished over the course of several months. This Soviet spy hunt rocked the counter-intel world. Mysterious fatal illnesses, accidental deaths, drownings, people having strokes behind closed doors. Just like Stalin, no one knew who was behind it. But all you need to do was look for who had the motive. They were all taken out by a man without a face. And now we've got an idea of how he did it too. He'd gotten revenge for his people, but he wasn't finished. Skullface defected to the West, eventually ended up with the SAS. That's where he met Zero. It's possible he began planning this whole thing back then. It's hard to say. In any case, Zero made him his XO. He always did have a thing for oddballs. But this one was set to lead a unit no one else would know about. When Zero created Fox, he also formed XOF as a support team. An unconventional special forces unit designed to support Fox, make it stronger, with Skullface given the orders. Zero never even told the boss about it, nor the CIA, naturally. If Fox was Zero's silver bullet, XOF was the recoil when he pulled the trigger, just like Newton's third law. While you were with Fox, Skullface was operating behind the scenes, sometimes as your backup, sometimes as a mole or a scout, sometimes as your cleanup crew. Fox's tail, making sure the mission succeeded and that you survived. We only have his word to go on, but Skullface's goal was revenge against those who'd use language to subjugate people. Those corrupting a people's identity by forcing a new tongue on them. Those using the power of language to control information. Naturally, that set his sights on Zero. To Zero, English was simply the most convenient code. But to Skullface, English was a parasite. And by eradicating it, he'd stop the world from being eaten away. If that didn't work, he was ready to see the world scorched by nuclear fire. to save language, culture, and race from annihilation. He was willing to overstep the hands of the Doomsday Clock. That is, of course, if you believe anything he had to say.
You know, when you brought back all the child soldiers who escaped, Eli knew they'd returned. Needless to say, nobody said a word to him.
I guess they got a message to him somehow.
Eli wasn't put in the corner in time out. He was locked up in that room, completely cut off from the outside world.
Then how'd he find out?
There's only one possibility I can think of. The Soviet Union has been researching military applications for psi phenomena.
Psi?
Things like psychokinesis and ESP, extrasensory perception.
You mean moving objects without touching them? Knowing what card somebody's holding up? Psychic powers? Come on. I thought that was just another bunch of disinformation aimed at the West.
Just bear with me a second. One type of ESP is telepathy. It's the ability to know another person's thoughts through nonverbal means.
You're saying Eli read our minds?
It's the only idea that doesn't involve someone getting to him.
Ocelot.
Look, psi research isn't some hocus-pocus. It's all evidence-based, scientific...
There's gotta be another explanation. Maybe one of the kids stuck a note to your back.
I hope that's the case. But I am convinced that they have, or Eli has, a connection to some force we have yet to identify. You better watch yourself, boss.
How am I supposed to do that?
If he is depending on something for help, well, that's his Achilles heel. If you can figure out what that something is, you might be able to use it against him.
I'll keep that in mind.
Oh, and the medical team is looking after the kids left on Mother Base. For the moment, they don't seem too panicked. But boss, get this. Eli got those kids to plot their armed uprising as a diversion. Also, he could steal Sahelanthropus and escape. That brat got us good. Set us up and knocked us down. And then there's that mystery kid who was with Eli. If those two working together, I'd say things won't be over for a long time yet.
After exposure to the blood of a symptomatic colleague, I found myself making my way up the stairs to this room. And I am not alone. Everyone who's infected, we've all come up here wanting to get outside. I know full well I mustn't leave, given the possibility I'm infected. Yet, I can't contain this urge I feel inside me, like the alcoholic who tries to make any excuse for one more drink. Every step I took up those stairs filled me with this sense of bliss. I still have all my wits about me. It took no time at all to rewire the electronic lock and open the emergency exit. Then, just as I was about to set foot outside, I finally realized what was going on. This desire for freedom is not my own, but that of the vocal cord parasites inside me. They want the ravens to feed on us, pecking us to death. Attracted by these sweet secretions, they have mutated to facilitate this. The sweet smell is powerful enough to attract even a species with such a weak nose. So, before the parasites take complete control, I must. Most of the staff in here are already infected. At least, everyone I've looked at is. Infection with this parasite causes a high fever in the pharynx. I have modified a pair of night vision goggles to react only to this temperature range. With these goggles, you can identify who is infected. Other infected will, like me, feel compelled to make it outside. If the ravens get their meal, they'll head for land next. That cannot be allowed to happen.
The whole idea of the vocal cord parasites was that they'd only copulate once exposed to a specific language over time. But the parasites infecting our men in the laboratory laid their eggs straight away. The larvae were eating their lung tissue almost immediately. What kind of mutation was it?
Those who were infected and cured still carried the vocal cord parasites in their throats. They were still there, but the males had been rendered female by the Bolbachia, and copulation could not occur, so we thought. But it is the Bolbachia that mutated.
Not the parasites?
You remember I told you the Bolbachia attempts to maximize its number of female infected hosts?
Yes, hence the male-to-female transformation.
Precisely. But other Bolbachia strains use different methods. Cytoplasmic incompatibility, killing the males, and parthenogenesis.
Parthenogenesis? Aphids? Aphids use that to reproduce via females only.
Very good. The females lay their eggs without a male present, creating clones of themselves in explosive numbers. Parthenogenesis was originally a means for an organism to take maximum advantage of abundant resources by increasing its numbers. Certain strains of Bolbachia forced this to occur, to create more and more infected females.
And that's why our men develop symptoms in the blink of an eye.
Wolbachia causing parthenogenesis is common in parasitic wasps. Of course, the Wolbachia I introduced to your men did not have this characteristic. But I believe the mutation, whatever it was, caused it to force parthenogenesis in its host, the vocal cord parasites. The Wolbachia we used to prevent egg laying became the agent of limitless reproduction.
There's something else. The symptomatic infected in the laboratory all wanted to get outside, even knowing there was napalm waiting for them out there. You said the parasites made them act that way, but parasites controlling humans. Is it possible?
Parasites altering the host's behavior is a common occurrence in the world of nature. Long ago, the vocal cord parasites had this ability, but even I never foresaw they might control humans. Until I heard the things your man said.
You mean the researcher on the top floor? The bit about, I'm not a snail.
Yes. Among parasitic worms, there is a genus called Leucochloridium that uses snails as intermediary hosts. As you know, snails prefer dark, gloomy environments. But once parasitized by Leucochloridium, they desire to be in the light. And that is not all. The parasitic worms thrust themselves into the snail's antennae, making them swell to abnormal size. The snail, meanwhile, frantically wiggles its antennae as the parasites squirm inside. The swollen, wriggling antennae soon resemble caterpillars.
I don't get it.
It is so they can be eaten by birds. Leucochloridium needs a bird as its definitive host. To breed, they require their snail host to be snapped up by a predator. So they make the humble snail appear to be a delicious caterpillar and lead it to somewhere in open sight.
So you mean the staff trying to get outside?
Was so the birds could peck at them. The parasites altered their mental state, making them crave higher places and to be outdoors. I can only surmise that both the Wolbachia and the parasites mutated. Before the ancestors of the vocal cord parasites infected humans, their hosts were birds.
What we saw in the laboratory was some throwback to that time. The parasites attempting to make birds their intermediary hosts.
It sounds insane.
A praying mantis that is host to a parasitic hairworm will dive into water and drown itself, just so the hairworm can lay its eggs in water. Rats infected with Toxoplasma gondii lose their instinctive caution and run right up to cats. Just some of the many ways parasites control the host.
But we're humans. Surely our minds are too complex for that.
I thought just the same. Free will is what makes us human. So it never occurred to me that the parasites could be controlling the symptomatic. But the mood, the will of a person can be easily affected by the balance of their cerebral substances. Take the toxoplasma I mentioned. It does infect humans, and it is thought the infected develop a more reckless attitude.
But to think that mutations occurred in both the Wolbachia and its parasite hosts.
Your observation is most apt. Both mutations occurring at once indicates the presence of a powerful mutagen.
I see. Keep working on narrowing down what it was.
So, as if putting me on stage to sing was not enough, Miller even expected me to write the lyrics. He even said he had thought of the title already. Love Deterrence. As if he had done the hard part. Deterrence? Love Deterrence? Deterrences? It is when nuclear weapons prevent war, right? I do not see how love fits in. But it was too late to complain, so I just sat and listened to the tape of Miller's backing guitar and the professor's melody over and over again. I guess the melody is more Professor Galvez's creation than Miller's, but on the whole, I think it is actually a good song. First, it goes for your heart with a sorrowful opening, but then you feel revitalized as the song goes on. Miller grew up in post-war Japan. Maybe that is why the song has that kind of balance. Long ago, I heard some Japanese music called Enka, I think? It sounded this way. But I wonder why it has to sound sad in the first place. Miller called it Love Deterrence. Doesn't that mean he had a love song in mind? All I see of Miller and women is the way he fools around with a lot of them at once. But maybe he has had his heart broken too. And what about me? I found myself thinking about Chico and Snake as well. I know Chico has a crush on me. So naturally he should come to mine. But why Snake? He saved me, and I feel indebted to him. But I thought that was all he meant to me. Why does my heart flutter when I think of him? It is embarrassing to be unable to control this emotion. There has to be a way to suppress it, to forget it. But maybe that is what love deterrence is? With that thought in mind, I went to my desk and began to write and write. Just 3 days left until Peace Day. I finally had a decent draft of the lyrics, so I showed them to Professor Galvez first. He liked them. He said I had done a superb job capturing the sense of a young girl's troubled heart. There were one or two lines I thought needed brushing up, so although he said lyrics aren't my specialty at first, he gave me some advice. Everything he said made perfect sense. When I tried putting in his changes, they made the song feel deeper, more sincere. That is the professor for you. He always has the answer. With the lyrics finished, I was ready to show Miller. He does not often take things seriously, but all of a sudden, he was saying, "Paz, you have the soul of an Enka songwriter." And I did not even listen to Enka all that much. Maybe I am pretty talented after all. But still, it took so much time to write the lyrics that there is hardly any time left to rehearse before Peace Day. The three of us rushed into the makeshift practice studio on Mother Base to see how we sounded together. Miller strummed away with a big smile on his face. I sang the main melody, and Professor Galvez improvised a backup melody. I know the professor is smart, but is there anything he cannot do? And Miller's guitar playing sounded a lot better now that he stopped singing. But I can hardly criticize his voice. I thought I had learned the song well enough listening to the tape as I wrote the lyrics, but I had trouble with the pitch and kept missing the rhythm. I have to practice, but there's almost no time left. It is just 3 days until Beast Day. Wait, I thought there were 3 days left before. I went and checked today's date with Miller and the professor. The date has not changed. It is the same day. Something is strange. Am I reliving the same day?
Rise and shine, old-timer. It is complete. I had our best and brightest working overtime, fine-tuning the greatest burger the world has ever known. I call it the Chemical Burger.
What on earth is that color?
Now, don't judge a burger by its color. Go on, try it.
I am not very hungry.
What? Oh, I get it. Now, sure, it's loaded with additives, but each one's been approved by the WHO for human consumption. Come on, one little bite's not gonna kill you.
Are you sure of that? Fine.
Well, what do you think?
It is perfect.
Right?
This takes me back to the taste of my youth. The neon signs on the Mother Road. Oh, I can see them now.
So, what do you think of our signs now? And it doesn't just taste great. You won't believe how cheap it is to make. And because it's pumped up with preservatives, it won't spoil easily in regions lacking refrigerated storage or transportation infrastructure. This bad boy could even solve Africa's hunger problem.
Excuse me?
People will no longer fight over food or find reason to hate one another. Mankind will come together, reunited between these fluffy buns. Forget Pax Americana. Say hello to Pax Hamburgana.
Pax Hamburgana.
Skullface thought that destruction was the way to free the peoples of the world from American imperialism. But this is different. Tackling something head-on just makes for more conflict. Only by uniting the world can its various inhabitants truly become free. Having lived as an American parasite as long as I have, I know what I'm talking about. The Chemical Burger is poised to be the greatest liberating force the world has ever known.
An ethnic liberator. Burger.
Now all I need is a better brand image, starting with a name. Gotta run, old-timer. I'll catch you later.
Wait, what are you talking about? Just what do you plan to do?
Present the charges against you, and render an appropriate punishment.
You're gonna put me on trial?
Call it what you like.
What's the meaning of this?
Out of here, all of you. Back to your posts.
No, hang on. Yui has killed their comrades and interfered with their lives. They've had all they can take.
Kill her!
Stop! This is insane! You have no evidence whatsoever. You say you're an army free from government. You talk big about being a nation unto yourselves. But from the outside, you're just thugs, rebels, a militia, terrorists, an unhinged threat to society. You're nothing but a bunch of psychopaths.
So you're not with us?
No! I didn't...
I thought we were on the same side. That's too bad.
I didn't...
Men, you will have justice. But our organization, the boss's organization, is built on order and reason. There will be no lynch mob. So stand down for today. We will gather all the evidence of this man's crimes. And then he will be tried. Dismissed!
What do you think you're doing?
go ahead and execute me. It'll be murder in the eyes of the world. You've lost your minds. Don't you get it? You're seeing phantoms. Just look at that dog. No, you named him D-Dog, but it's obvious anyone could see that's a wolf, because you're all a bunch of wild dogs. You wanted to believe he was too, to feel some connection, to fight your loneliness. You wanted something to cling to prove you deserve to be alive. You wanted to forget the death, your sins, so you'd cling on to dogs, or wolves, or even Big Boss. The boss is the same, isn't he? Every one of you is alone. That's why you suspect your own. I know, because I do the same. I'm one of you too. Alone. Open your eyes! What you're doing is murder, plain and simple. All you ever create is war. War and violence can never lead to peace.
Boss, we've gone over the prisoner transport log you found. Quiet was grabbed by the Soviets and moved to Lamar Hatte Palace. They lost a lot of men to her. Can't blame them for wanting payback. But why did she just let herself get captured?
I think it is time you knew. Quiet was carrying vocal cord parasites. The English strain, to be precise.
The third English pair.
Skullface was using her as a vector. An ace in the hole if his assassination plan failed.
I knew it.
But Quiet chose not to speak. She told me the situation in Diné, Navajo, the only language to which the parasites do not react. If you found out, she could not remain among you. And yet, she refused the Wolbachia treatment. Why? Because part of her still wanted revenge against you.
Revenge against the boss?
In order to stay here, she took a vow of eternal silence. But then, that sudden mutation showed this was not enough. As long as the parasites were inside her, she could not predict what might happen.
And that's why she took off, sacrificing herself to make sure the English strain died with her?
Maybe. Or maybe she only wants to infect the world. Whatever her plan, we can't let her go free. The vocal cord parasites are the last of Skullface's legacy. It's up to us to erase it. Boss, the targets are Quiet and the English strain she's carrying. Your objective is to extract her. But if worst comes to worst, she may have to be eliminated. Both her and the parasites.
We don't know for sure what Quiet's up to, but we need to secure her ASAP. She's being held at Lamar Hatte Palace. Make your way there.
I did not choose to be quiet. I wanted to express my feelings to you. If only we shared a common tongue. Vengeance was what drove me to them. The only language left to me, revenge. But the words we shared, no, that was no language at all. That is why I chose the language of gratitude instead and go back to silence. I am quiet. I am the absence of words.
The R&D team's going to take over Emmerich's work. He may be gone, but it won't affect us one bit.
We'll be able to deliver whatever you need just like before. You can depend on that. One other thing. I'm tracking his whereabouts. Nothing to report at the moment, though.
Let it go. He's gone. The guy's gone.
I know. I just want to be sure. Not like I'm losing sleep over this son of a bitch.
Open this thing! Huey! Damn it, Huey! Open it now! Please! Let me out!
Kill me.
Kill me!
If only I'd tried to get out sooner. Perhaps I'd have made it. Why didn't I stop the hatch from closing? Even if it meant losing an arm. But you can hear me, can't you, Joy? I know you can. You're recording all of this. Deep down, in some memory vault he'll never find. Duplicating it. Burying it under heaps of meaningless code. Anyway, I guess I can say what needs to be said. I can still do that much. Talk to you. Even if I can't face you. Even if there's a heaven. Even if you're waiting there, I don't deserve to see you again. I don't deserve to love you. I signed up for Zero's plan. Even now that he's halfway to dead, his plan lives on. Leeching away at the world. And it took your strength to make it happen. In using you, I put the world in his palm. Once and for all. Zero. Zero. Or whoever it is who's taken its name. They found me. After the Caribbean. They made me simulate his will. So that even after the body was gone, that will would keep the world turning the way they were. I had no choice. They dredged Lago Cosibolca, pulled up your phantom, forced me to revive and modify you. I thought I could bring you back, but in the end, I sold your will to him. Now this part is just one big shell. A husk. Your phantom's no longer here. As for me, everything I touch turns to ashes. I could never make anyone happy. And now I'll never see my son again. But at least Hal's free from his father's hands. Me with child. Can you imagine? I wonder how you took the news. Were you jealous? I knew what I was doing. If I could pass your will onto a child I carried, my genes, your meme, a father would be irrelevant. If I did that, that child would be ours. See through the dream. The false you I created. I only wanted to pass your will on to the next generation. But Zero took it away. And now I haven't just lost you. I've lost my... Hal, can you forgive the mother who couldn't protect you? The one who let them take it all away from us. There's still hope. You, the one he took away. He'll never break your will. The will to make this world the way you saw it could be. I buried code, just to be sure. Inside of you, there is an egg. And when someone finds it, when they crack it, there'll be nothing left to stop you. The world you envisioned will become a reality. Joy.
World will protect you.
You don't need me. You just need to be strong enough for the both of us.
Approaching.
It appears I was looking at things wrong.
What do you mean?
All of you. Until now, I had thought of your organization, Diamond Dogs, as a superorganism.
You'll have to explain that one.
The term refers to a unit of eusocial insects like ants or bees. While made up of many individuals, they behave as though they are one organism, with the queen as their nerve center. The close ties you share here reminded me of that.
Well, the boss's efforts do pull us all together.
I was not finished. I'm speaking in terms of homogeneity. You come from all walks of life, do you not? Many races and tongues, talents and pasts, complementing each other, influencing each other, making Diamond Dogs the unique group that it is.
Of course. We have no use for mindless drones around here.
Is that so? Then perhaps an organization like yours is a truer superorganism than the ants and bees.
Meaning?
Most organisms adapt to their environment by coexisting with other species. Take the cow, for instance. Its rumen, the first stomach, contains an incredible number of bacteria, which digest the food it has consumed. Without their help, the cow could not break down the fiber in grasses. The cow has to outsource its means of survival to them.
You don't say.
Man is the same. Some 100 trillion bacteria live inside the human intestines. Without the bacteria, they could not function properly. And it does not stop there. The stomach, the mouth, the skin, even the placenta contains bacteria that coexist with us. The same is true of parasites. In fact, the human immune system has evolved based on parasites being a part of it. Without them, the immune system can run amok and even damage other parts of the body.
This is all very interesting, but what does it have to do with Diamond Dogs?
A harmonious superorganism is made up not of a group of homogeneous individuals, but of diverse individuals that complement each other. That is what I saw in your group here. Then it occurred to me that man is a superorganism. Man's phenotype is not determined solely by his genetics. Some say if you mapped the genomes of all bacteria in the human body, the result would be over 100 times bigger than the human genome. The sum of man's genome and those of the organisms he coexists with, call it a metagenome, creates the superorganism we know as a human being.
Well, now that's quite a leap.
You think so? Then try a broader perspective. If our world were a human body, you would be parasites. You make a living by doing the dirty work that the world powers cannot handle themselves. From their perspective, you are likely a nuisance. But without you, pus would build up around the world, and autotoxemia, self-poisoning, would follow. The world needs your kind.
Thank goodness for that.
Skullfaced forced me to turn parasites into weapons. Creatures with which we are supposed to coexist. Meanwhile, that foundation I worked with focused solely on the human genome. Apparently thinking that manipulating it would get them whatever new form they want. Both ways are mistakes. Neither is a true superorganism. I am Dine, by speaking with those living inside me. We enhance one another and enjoy harmonious growth. Such was the original purpose of my research. You have made me remember this.
Well, it's an honor. You can travel the world, but you won't find another place like this. If the whole world was like this base, I think the peoples of the world would bid farewell to fighting for good. Maybe that's what the boss wanted in the end.
I want to thank you, Code Talker. Your pinpointing the cause of the vocal cord parasite's mutation enabled us to purge an enemy from Mother Base.
You mean that scientist?
Yeah, I was convinced he betrayed us. But I was wrong. He was never on our side to begin with. So ultimately, there was no traitor among us. And yet I made everyone distrustful with my talk of spies. The end result being men turning on each other in the laboratory.
You must not blame yourself. They were all infected with a mutated strain. The outcome would have been the same.
You know, we defeated Skullface, but it didn't lessen our pain. It's a pain we'll never be rid of. I see that now, but I thought I could burn it away. In the end, all I burned was our own men.
Infectious diseases, parasites. Without such foreign enemies, the immune system will start attacking the body, developing allergies and autoimmune diseases. The same is true of organizations.
You're right.
But I do not deserve to rebuke you. My desire to retaliate against the English language is what attracted me to the vocal cord parasites in the first place. Had it not been for that, I would never have been used by Skullface. We both allowed revenge to crawl into our minds and lay its eggs.
Sahelanthropus will unleash that thirst unto the future. How long are we going to be tormented by what he left behind?
There is no choice but to live with that pain. Be symbiotic with our vengeful nature. Whatever we do, we must not allow that thirst for revenge to control us.
Boss, how are you back on your feet so quickly?
There's a non-smoking ward.
Boss,
if I listened to everything the doctors said, I'd probably die in here. No point waking up after 9 years for that.
Well, having you out of that bed makes things a little easier.
Bad news, huh?
Things are looking worse.
Go on.
They found out about you waking up. And the man on fire picked this time to wake up, too. We'll have to move forward ahead of schedule. Miller already has the preparations underway. We'll have to wake up your neighbor, too.
So he's not... He seems awake now.
No. Well, he's not actively conscious yet, at least.
He was a doctor, too.
In his mind, that past no longer exists. Your past is his past now. He's going to be your phantom. Not some simple diversion. He'll act as the new big boss. And the act just isn't for Cypher. He'll be your face on the world stage, until the time comes for your resurgence.
You make it sound easy.
We've been busy over the last 9 years. His altered state of consciousness has helped us implant powerful suggestions through induced hypnagogia. He's experienced all your missions on record and shares all your knowledge and experience to make him believe that he is the one true big boss.
No one around him will doubt that he's the big boss they know. So, is he the real big boss or a stand-in? What does that mean to him? Nothing. The human brain is capable of many illusions. Of pain, of the future. What happens from here depends on his skill. You can vouch for that.
He was always the best man we had.
But 9 years ago in that helicopter, he threw himself between you and the blast. In that moment, the man you knew died. He died protecting you. And now, by becoming you, he protects you again. This is just a detour in his journey to hell. And don't forget, it's what he wanted. He's in his dog days now. It's not just him. We'll be putting the people in this hospital in the line of fire. They'll be your shield and necessary diversion to buy us some time.
And you?
I'll be right by his side.
Can you keep it up? It's a hell of a lie.
It won't be a lie. I won't know his secret either. I'll believe that he's the real big boss. I'll have no conscious knowledge of you. Where's the lie in that?
Self-hypnosis.
It's nothing new in my line of work. Manipulating memories. The past. But that's not all. When the time is right, I need to remember that you're the real boss. In a world, it's doublethink.
In this year,
2 + 2 = 5. And I want you to do the same.
Right. His bodyguard?
Correct. It won't be long before this hospital comes under attack. We'll wake him up right away, but he won't be back to full health in time. You'll need to take him through his final paces.
Yeah. I want to see his face again.
All right. John. I've never forgotten you in these 9 years. But I have to forget you now.
Adam. I'm counting on you. What's up?
About the 1972 project. Les Enfants Terribles.
You never did like the French.
All that Catherine the Great aristocratic pompousness gets to me, that's all. Palace talk. They can keep it.
Les Enfants Terribles. The terrible children.
That madness Zero started. Or the start of his madness.
You found out something new?
The plan itself was abandoned in 76. ATGC dismantled the project, and their account with DARPA was closed. So I was worried about what happened to you. Your sons.
They're no sons of mine. And they're sure as hell not me.
Just a bunch of cells grown in a lab?
What they are is much sicker than that.
Well, Zero doesn't think so. Eva doesn't either. To them, those boys are your clones. They're you, down to the last hair.
And?
The first boys were raised free range, like we thought. Both of them. David has never left the States, but the other, Eli, has disappeared. Might as well call it abandoned. They're through with him.
Where is he?
He was in England, Zero's home ground. Apparently, he traveled to Africa after that, but that's where he escaped from Zero's care.
Just like that? Why?
Who knows? Maybe he found out about his birth. If he's alive, he'd be 11 or 12 by now. Old enough to think and act for himself.
So he might still be alive?
On his own, there? I wouldn't bet on it. John, if he is alive, what's the plan?
I have nothing to say to him. Treat him like a human being, just another person.
Boss, this war business you and Miller started. Since the industry spread out to the PFs, it may have a favorable influence on Cypher. To a ruler, an everlasting enemy is convenient. By directing the public's animosity outside his borders, he can unify their frame of mind. Guns for hire continue the war, then enrich the economy with their spoils. War as a business will become a permanent tool for manipulating the public mind. A new business model. You might even call it a war economy. Before long, Cypher, or rather the Patriots, will be drawn to this. Probably only a few decades before it takes hold. It's not far off at all. Still no leads on Zero. We don't even know whether he's still alive. But the protocol he put in motion's making steady progress. Every day, SIGINT's web covers a little bit more of the globe. Total information control. Big Brother Zero. And it'll happen before anyone even realizes. I don't like it. You're the big brother of the battlefield. You've earned a firm grip on the world's military power. But soon, Zero will have nations in his. He'll erase the Cold War, all war, from people's minds, and with it the world's borders. Zero's will, his influence, will be unleashed, with nothing to stem the tide. When that happens, opposition will no longer match the lines on the map. And boss, with no borders left, what difference can we make? War will have lost any true meaning to the world. Just one more gear keeping the wheels of economy turning. Another product bearing down the capitalist conveyor belt. The future your friend Miller wanted, that's all there is in store. Perhaps it's already too late. But human will should only be handed down and nurtured by human hands. It can't be entrusted to the system. Especially not that soulless phantom that Zero's left in his wake. No matter what happens, we'll have to fight someday to reclaim our truth. Until next time, Big Boss. Someone has successfully struck at Zero. Since Zero's using a private network, we get information, but we have no way to trace his location. That means the details are still fuzzy at this point, but apparently some new bioweapon was used. As soon as he noticed the dip in his vital signs, he had his stomach pumped and even underwent blood dialysis. But he didn't fully recover. Ironically, if Zero kept more company, he'd have been safe. Since the incident, his speech and actions have been getting more unhinged by the day. He's probably been rushed to another safe house for intensive care. But the location is a complete mystery. That's the way he operates. He went to incredible lengths to make sure his great escape went unnoticed. So far, I know at least Langley and the Pentagon were involved. He had a blackout triggered in New York to disrupt the transportation and information grids, and at least two submarines were sighted off the coast. The personnel involved were working off a cover story. Naturally, the White House was fed the same thing. The project is buried under a pile of dummy ops and backup plans stretching across multiple organizations. It's safe to say not one of the people involved knew what they were moving or to where. All top secret, no trail, no leads. He's living up to his name as usual. Only this time, even I can't find him. Now, the only record of his location lies within the Cypher AI that was at the heart of the escape plan. And that's closed off, with its data sealed away in a secret location. Skullface was able to put together this assassination attempt, but even he can't possibly know where Zero is now. I'll keep searching, but when you're up against he who controls information, it's gonna be a long battle. Boss, it was Anderson after all. That's right, the man who went by SIGINT during Operation Snake Eater. Following Zero's disappearance, he's taken over command of Cypher. Well, to be precise, the AI he oversees has. The idea to have an AI act for Zero came about in 74, when the data from the mammal pod penetrated NORAD. Clearly, an AI couldn't be allowed to make its own decisions. So they would take away its ability to act, and instead, create a specialized system in which the AI, bound by specific rules, filters the massive amounts of data it collects before passing it on to people, subtly guiding their decision-making. A system of the people, by the people, for the people. So they began researching how to do it. DARPA apparently brought Strangelove on board to head it up. She was forced out after a certain incident. The direction of the project and any trace of her existence was scrubbed after her departure. Before Zero lost consciousness as his condition worsened, he left instructions for Anderson, through a cutout, of course. Zero went out of his way to hide your location in order to keep you safe. This meant sacrificing his own protection. It was the only way to ensure you could stand alone as your own man. And here I am, the only link between you and the world that's passing you by. I'm your last connection now. This was Zero's last request, his will. Once you're awake, we need to discuss the best way to ensure your safety. Oh, and they've got a name for Anderson's AI project. It's called the Patriots. It's all about ensuring that the concepts driving society appears the same in the mind of each person in that society. about maintaining the identity of the individual, and yet having that individual willingly make up part of the whole. I guess it's fitting to call that patriotism, creating a united world. Zero's will is already fading into a shadow of what it once was. Systems, guidelines, rules, laws. When you take a mentality and fix it in a solid shape, put it out there in the hands of people, it can only begin to decay. No mentality can last forever. When the body dies, the will dies with it.
Hello?
Not there. Here.
Huh?
Thank you for coming. Please.
You're...
Is it that odd? I suppose the cuffs have gotten a bit loose. Although, truth be told, I have been spending more time in pajamas as of late.
No. Nothing.
The tie, perhaps. Not the most fashionable pattern, I admit.
No, it is very nice.
How sweet. Will you take a little brandy? You're hardly underage, after all.
No, thank you.
Please, sit. Pacifica Ocean.
What?
Ah, yes. You've already begun. Not bad. A schoolgirl through and through. Even he won't suspect otherwise. Here you are.
Thank you. I heard you were sick?
Poppycock. I just like to take a little time off work.
You?
You must feel that way sometimes.
Well...
Anyway, I could hardly greet my first guest from that damned bed.
I missed my chance to catch you snoring.
Now I'm twice as glad I got ready in time. Drink, before it gets cold. English breakfast tea. All I have, I'm afraid. There were 8 candidates before you, meaning you will be the 9th Paz Ortega Andrade.
What happened to the others?
They're in the next room. They've been taking it easy these past few months.
They...
Do you see any windows here?
No.
I've gotten used to it, this life. I am who I am, after all. And I've had my fill of cursing this bloody dungeon. Excuse me. But I can't help sometimes wishing I could see the stars. What should I do?
Well, you could go outside, go up to the roof, wait for the clouds to pass. You would have a view of Manhattan, and a pretty one too. But once the wind blows, and the clouds pass, you can look up and see a sky full of stars, even here.
You've had a hard time getting to where you are.
Yes.
Sewer rats lead better lives. I know. Extreme training. Starvation. Days spent without sleep. Abandoned, hurt, and all but killed in every way imaginable. Some of your compatriots died. Others betrayed you, left you for dead. And you did the same to them. But through it all, you survived. And you alone made it here. Just look at you. I can see everything you've been through.
Yes.
Consider this mission a reward for the mountain you've climbed.
Thank you.
Yes, well, you know what's next.
Yes.
And you are prepared?
Yes.
I believe you. That ever so slight tan. Not the type you'd get on the West Coast. If I didn't know better, I'd say you really did grow up around the equator. But it runs deeper than that. One look at you, and I see a wide-eyed student yearning for peace. Born and raised in Central America. I can see it all. How much preparation have you done?
A little.
You'll be perfect for this, to strike back at Snake. I'll share everything I know about him. But you mustn't forget who you're dealing with. If he were to get the better of you, well, I deeply regret having put you in that position. But beyond that, I'm putting my life in your hands.
You can trust me, Cypher.
None of my friends call me that. Tea's gone cold. Shall I make some more?
I know we are the only ones here. There is no one in the other room.
And how do you know that?
You said I was your first guest.
Oh, I haven't had this much fun in quite a while. All right, then.
Cypher's been in hiding ever since his grand experiment. No one's seen him in years.
All we hear are orders delivered by proxy. Except you. You met with him, face to face, in order to contact Big Boss. Tell me where he is. Where is Cypher? Where is Zero? I've never known choice. Where I was born, the language I speak. I've never had the freedom to choose for myself. But you, right now, are free. Do as you will.
This will save Big Boss.
It may.
Will you really kill Zero for me?
Not for you.
All right. Zero is Hell's Kitchen, 10th Avenue. He is undergoing treatment there.
Not exactly Hyde Park.
His medical needs keep him from moving around. That is why he summoned me there. The other residents are of varying race and ages, but in reality, all 40 units are Cypher personnel. It took him 10 years to replace the original occupants. He has got places like this all over the world.
No better place to hide a needle than a stack of needles.
Zero is on the top floor. A room with no windows and no doors. Even the elevator does not reach it. Officially, that floor does not exist. The only access is by a secret staircase, one floor down. Room 702.
Shades of World War II.
Nobody realizes the entire building is a setup. People go in and out all day. But they're all cipher. The building blends right in with the rest of the city. They disseminate rumors that a gang operates out of the building. That keeps most outsiders away. And most of them are there as security, in case of an emergency. But even they don't know what they're really protecting. Foot traffic, goods coming in and out, phone lines, water and sewage. It is all monitored remotely by satellite and cameras inside and out. Should he need it, there's a sealed-off water conduit that can be used to escape to the Hudson River, and from there to the sea. But from the outside, it is just another building. A perfect disguise.
So the Major believes zero suspicion equals total security. Very bold. It's just the kind of ruse I'd expect from him. So long as no one's suspicions are aroused, you could hide there forever. On the other hand, if someone figures it out, there are dozens of ways in. And he's so paranoid about information slipping out, no one involved has the full picture. That ignorance is a weakness, the downfall of a need-to-know system. The pitfalls are clear. Circumventing them will be simplicity itself.
You hate him, don't you?
Hate? He never left me to die. I owe him my life. I'm bound to repay the favor. Any way I can. But that's not what you really want to know. What you want to know is, do I hate Big Boss? I don't hate the man.
Caution, rain approaching.
I do deserve a little more of his gratitude. But he probably has no idea who I am. So you see, I have no reason to hate him at all. I mean to have my revenge against Zero. It's not petty hatred or resentment. Nothing so personal. Even the hottest lava eventually cools, becoming a mountain. And that mountain becomes the land. Scalding steam comes back down as rain, forming rivers, draining into the sea. It's then that nature's order sets in. Now I'm merely a part of that cycle. Just like Zero. And you. And Big Boss.
Don't do it!
That lava, that vengeance, is already set as stone. Too late to change things now.
Don't kill him!
The choice is not mine to make.
Please, let Big Boss live!
Proceed.
Please.
Shh.
the shot already!
Hold her still!
It's me. Ocelot. It's been quite a while.
Yeah, I'll say.
Took a lot longer for you to surface than I expected, Major.
I wasn't planning on coming back at all, but I had no choice.
Well, after the Caribbean.
My hunch was proven right. You wouldn't believe who was behind it.
Oh, I have an idea. How did you respond?
Immediate disinformation campaign. Most bought into the story, but not everyone. It was quite an incident, after all. I couldn't cover everything. But I did hide the fact that Snake survived. And that should buy us some time.
Where is he?
En route to an old foxhole of mine. A base in the British sovereign area of Cyprus.
The military hospital at Dekelia?
Ava's leading the operation.
Ava? Following your orders?
Funny, isn't it? That we should all reunite like this.
This is an emergency. Otherwise, I sure as hell would...
Yes, yes. I don't expect you to bury the hatchet between us. Something simply won't ever happen. Even I can appreciate that. You too can only bear to speak with me from time to time. That's fine. But I don't want Snake to die. Surely we can come together on that. There are so few men I can turn to. And you're number one, Ocelot. Keep him hidden. Keep him safe. But I'll stay where I am and leave the rest to you. That's how he'd want it too.
Isn't it better for you to be there to supervise?
Where I am, where he goes, it makes no difference. All that matters is getting him the very best treatment and security. The latter being where you come in. Will he wake up? And if so, when? I have absolutely no idea. But as long as his heart is beating, he will keep fighting. So please, watch over him.
This location, it's safe?
No one will find him. And if they try, I will deal with them. The information must be suppressed.
Which is what you do best. Guess you're still at the top of your game, huh?
Anything but. I'm sick, Ocelot. Donald's taken over a great deal. He'll be handling this situation from here on as well. Though I wish it weren't so. This will probably be the last time you and I speak. So, you won't say no, will you?
I have no choice.
Thank you.
Save your thanks.
One more thing. A proposition.
Yes.
I've prepared a ruse of sorts. One I imagine you'll quite like.
What is it?
You could say, I've made another snake.
Major?
I'm not talking about the children. A mental copy. His phantom, if you like.
I don't understand.
You will when you get to Cyprus. I've set the ball in motion, but the rest is in your hands. You're good at this kind of thing. The best. I need you on this.
If it's in his best interests.
I assure you, it is. Look after Snake. He's the toughest son of a bitch I've ever known. Yes, it's me. You weren't in hospital long. I had trouble finding you.
Where is he?
Safe. But in the same state as when you last saw him. We've had our misunderstandings, you and I. But as you've made clear, our relationship is strictly business. Therefore, I will limit this conversation to the business at hand. Please understand that I don't dislike you. Not inherently.
Where is Snake?
No, no. Settle down, or I'll have to hang up. And then you never hear from me again. Do you understand? First, about your boss. I had him moved once he was stabilized. I'm sure it came as quite a shock to you when you woke up. You'll have to forgive me.
I told him to stop putting me under.
Surely you understand. Specialized medical treatment in places like that can be positively nightmarish. We couldn't have left him there forever. And to be honest, I wasn't entirely comfortable leaving matters in your hands. Don't take it the wrong way. Anyone looking for him would be looking for you. He needed to be as far from you as possible. In fact, I'm still not sharing his location, even now. Problems could arise. So, instead, I'm giving you a point of contact. An introduction to a network of messengers who will lead you to a man. A friend to your boss. I'm sure he's mentioned him before. He knows Snake's location. More than any man alive, I trust him with this sort of thing. Keeping secrets, or men in the dark. He's known Snake quite a while. 10 years longer than you. Kazuhira, I don't care if you don't trust me, but I require your absolute trust in him on this. Snake will be brought back into this world, however long it takes. Understood? The only reason we're having this conversation is because you still have a role to play. Which brings me to the next issue. What happens after he regains consciousness? When Snake wakes up, and he will, he'll need your help again. So when he does, I promise you'll be the first to know. The code phrase will be, V has come too. I'll then mobilize all the necessary parties. Think of it as an overture to a prologue. Until then, do what you like. Just be ready when the time comes. But you don't need me to tell you that, do you? I know it's been hard on you too. But I can't imagine you're willing to just walk away.
What are you talking about? If what you're saying is true, then this is like wrapping a rope around your own neck and throwing it over a branch. What's your play in all this?
This is for Snake. So that he survives after he wakes up. Nothing more. After that, I don't care what you do.
Then tell me something.
Go on.
I only joined you after I found out what you were after. To make the world one, you need Snake for that. And he's already done a hell of a lot for you.
He has.
So on some level at least, I think you're being straight with me. Then why'd you do that to him? I get what you were trying with Paz. You wanted to get Snake any way you could. But after that, what you did, how could you do that to him?
After that wasn't me. You may not believe this, but I never intended for any of this to happen. My organization has many arms. It's just going to take a little longer before we're all on the same page. I admit, I may have been lax in my supervision, but something like that will not happen again.
Whatever. One day, I'll know the truth. Just as soon as the boss wakes up. And then we're coming after you. This ends with you begging us to put you out of your misery.
Is that so? Fantasy can make for a powerful ally. But remember this reality, Kazuhira Miller. Big Boss will wake up. And when he does, be there for him.
Major, I wondered whether you'd really call.
Exer, I presume this was your doing.
Do you like my gift?
I've been searching a long time for this.
It is what you were looking for, yes.
The winged dagger of a comrade lost to the sands of Egypt. He served under the boss back in Rayforce. I delivered this pin to her after his death. We were both so very young. From that moment on, she never let it leave her side.
She was still carrying it in Selenoyarsk. How about the back? Something wrong, Major?
Nothing, just pricked my finger.
The back.
The scar is there, just as I remember it. And this white stitching on the back. From the White Berets, the SAS wore in the early days. Ah.
Major?
30th of December, 1941. It's the inscription I made the day he died.
Of course.
His body was never recovered. This pin badge is the closest thing he has to a gravestone. When I gave it to her, she just kept on running her finger over the inscription. Never again, she uttered, as if reprimanding herself for his death. She pressed hard, embedding the inscription itself into her finger. You see, it's why this spot on the back looks shinier than the rest. He was our brother in arms.
So?
Yes, it's real. Thank you. There's no doubt about it.
Good. Now I have no regrets.
What do I owe you?
Nothing. Just want to talk for a moment.
Very well, then.
It's about our man, Major. He's been making some moves.
Miller? Yes, I know. Rhodesia, is it?
Yes, and up to his old tricks again.
No matter. He'll stumble soon enough.
Although he is under my jurisdiction now.
And that's what you want to talk about?
Not exactly. You see, my being here has made me realize I can still be of use to you.
How so?
This country is rich with biological resources. Bacteria, nematodes, viruses. I'm sure we can find something here to bring that plan back into action.
Forget it. The Cleanser Project was just another one of my predecessor's daydreams.
And the vocal cord parasites?
Were an excellent test case for reverse evolution. Nothing more. What matters now is the genetics technology behind that work. With genetics, the clumsiness in targeting an entire race isn't an issue. We can target specific individuals. No need to breed multiple generations of parasite just to get results.
But I...
Don't be quaint, Exo. Once the Cold War is over, our enemies won't be so clearly defined. Using human alone won't be enough. An electronic network will span the globe, and our enemies will blend right into it.
You may be right, but will people really settle for an enemy they can't see? Men want to feel righteous, need to see the evil in the enemy they fear. Without it, they'll turn their aggressions inward, find an enemy inside. You know this is true.
I see what you're saying. Just as those robbed of their parasites develop allergies and autoimmune diseases, a man robbed of his enemy develops self-destructive tendencies. And I know all the symptoms. Ethnic conflict, religious strife, terrorism. And with asymmetrical conflict, deterrence is a joke. That's why we must depend on information control. People need an appropriate context for their lives. A context that's stimulating without being destructive. That balance is the basis of equilibrium.
You mean to say people will blindly accept your context without developing any allergies?
If we're to unite the world, literacy must be suppressed. To suppress the information immune system, to borrow your metaphor.
Immunity to information. But to ensure there's no allergic reaction, while the immune system fights off parasites and pathogens.
It's done, Exo. This world will become one. I have found the way. The world that the boss envisioned will finally become a reality. Race, tribal affiliations, national borders, even our faces will be irrelevant. The nature of communication itself will change. And it will make mankind whole again.
Some things can't be undone. My face was taken from me. There's no taking that back.
A face means nothing when one's soul is able to communicate directly with another.
I have no intention of hiding behind your technological veil, Major. I wear my broken visage, this skull in the open, so that I may never forget what I've lost.
You. What are you?
The chain of retaliation is what will truly bind this world together as one. Major?
You son of a... The pin. You...
Yes, the pin. It's too late. They can't extract it. You see, Major, some things can't be undone.
How did you find me? The girl. You made her talk.
I'm sorry I couldn't visit or thank you in person, but it has been lovely chatting. And now that I know you're no longer interested in the garden, it's time for you to step aside. You're a busy man, lots to do. So I've left you a little time.
Go to hell! How dare you? You planned this all along. Had your own agenda. All these years. Yeah.
Now you see, the world can never truly become one.
But the boss... I've been...
You've been wrong.
You're no different. Just like him. None of you understand the world she saw.
I would say the same to you, Major.
You steal it all away. Everything.
The boss said the same thing. Only I understood what she meant. Major... I'll handle the rest. Oh, and one more thing. That pin badge, it was a fake. I held on to the real one. I'll take good care of it. And continue the boss's work.
Jack.
I almost thought you wouldn't come.
Well, you're supposed to visit hospital before you die.
But how did you get here?
My friends at the SAS know how to keep a secret. The trip to the airport was a little dramatic, but the rest was easy. Still, I've had smoother rides. Oh, look. Scalded myself with my tea. I won't be staying long.
I understand.
Which one is he?
On the right.
And the left?
We did just as you instructed.
Has either of them woken?
Neither of them, no.
Not once?
Not in 2 years. Their weekly EEG shows stable activity levels. There's been practically no change.
Jack,
Jack. It's me. You look fit to run a country mile.
Every 4 hours, we move all of their muscles, subject them to load. They're stable, but eventually...
Yes, of course.
We've done everything we can to ensure they're ready to move, should they wake up. Still, it's been a pretty long time. How long will they be here?
Indefinitely. It's too dangerous to move them. And so far, no one knows they're here.
I see.
I am most grateful to you. And I need you to keep it up.
We'll do everything we can.
Can you give us a moment?
Of course.
Jack, can you hear me? Nice place, isn't it? I went to a lot of trouble bringing you here. Here where no one will find you. Still, the Ocelot's on guard duty, just in case. Maybe knowing that will help you sleep better. I had no intention of coming, but... this... could be my last chance. If you'd just come to see me first. Do you remember the last time I visited you in hospital? Our first mission together. After the boss threw you in that river, broke your arm. Ah, the good old days. I never told you this, but I had another team at my disposal back then, with a very special man leading it. Maybe he didn't like the arrangement. In any case, this man, he seems to have done something to me. Which is why I'm quite sick myself. Up here, there's nothing they can do. I always was the forgetful type, as you know. I'm all right for now, but they say it's a one-way street. If you don't wake up soon, I won't remember you when you do. I don't mind about myself, but what he did to you, I can never forgive. I've sent him to Africa, and I doubt he's coming back. Jack, once your little holiday here is over, well, who knows when that will be? But anyway, I probably won't be around. I'll be somewhere even you can't find me. A tombstone chiseled into the code of a machine. That is all I leave to mark my existence. Wake up soon, old friend. Time is running short.